Hi, I'm Dr. Steve Pod from the RD&E Hospital, and this is the follow-on video from the tutorial on bradyarrhythmia. It's meant to test your understanding of the degrees of heart block and whether they're dangerous or not dangerous. And some of them will just introduce some new concepts. Some of the ECGs may require some time to look at, so rather than pausing, if you pause the video, to make your diagnoses before continuing. So, this is the first ECG here. If you start with the basics, the rate, rhythm, and axis, hopefully you can see that firstly, it is an irregular rhythm and there are no obvious P waves. Also, the rate is bradycardic in that the RR interval is over 5 big squares. The axis is normal because 1 and lead 2 are both positive. So we have a irregular rhythm with narrow QRS and bradycardia with no discernible P waves. This therefore shows atrial fibrillation, but the fact that the ventricular rate is irregular means it's still conducting to the ventricle. So this is slow atrial fibrillation. This in itself does not require treatment unless the patient is symptomatic. If the patient is on high levels of rate control medication, such as digoxin or beta blocker, this could be stopped to try and improve rate before consideration of other therapies, such as pacemaker, if the patient is symptomatic. Irregular and slow, slow atrial fibrillation. If you look at this ECG, when we look at the rate, rhythm, and axis, the axis again is normal as the QRSs in lead 1 and lead 2 are both positive. However, the atrial depolarization, there are no discernible P waves, and there is a fibrillation or a wander to the line. So the atrial rhythm here is atrial fibrillation. The QRS is over 3 small squares, so is broad. And the rate is definitely over 5 big squares, representing bradycardia. So we have atrial fibrillation with a broad bradycardic QRS. And the key is that atrial fibrillation should be irregular. But when we look here at the RR interval, it is exactly regular. What this tells us is that the impulses or the depolarization from the atrial fibrillation are not conducting through the AV node, because that would produce an irregular rhythm, as we have seen on the previous ECG. What we have here is a regular ventricular rate with atrial fibrillation in the atrium, i.e. the atrium is dissociated from the ventricle. This is therefore complete heart block with underlying atrial fibrillation. This is extremely important to recognize because you don't have the normal P waves that are dissociated from your QRS. This is going to need urgent treatment, particularly as the escape rhythm is broad and slow. So, atrial fibrillation with complete heart block. Sticking on the theme of atrial fibrillation, this is a patient that has had an implantable loop monitor placed, likely because of the symptoms of dizziness or syncope. To help you along at the beginning of this rhythm strip, the heart rate is irregular and there's no clear P wave. It is not bradycardic. If anything, it is tachycardic. So the patient is in fast atrial fibrillation. However, there is then a pause with a P wave and a single QRS. And then if we look along the rhythm strip, there is a period of asystole that goes on for well over 10 seconds before there is return of rhythm. The rhythm does have a P wave and a narrow QRS with a normal PR interval. This is a good example of post-cardioversion pause. What that means is that when the patient is in atrial fibrillation, the atria is depolarizing at between 300 to 600 beats per minute. This means that the sinus node is continuously depolarized, and hence you do not get an organized P wave. However, on termination of atrial fibrillation, it will take time for the sinus node to recover to coordinate and produce a P wave. In this example, it has taken over 10 seconds for the sinus node to produce a reliable rhythm. This may be due to sinus node disease, as the patient has atrial fibrillation, or could be because of drug therapy, such as digoxin or beta blocker. Post-cardioversion pauses are caused by sinus node disease or a sinus node problem. And if you remember from the tutorial, it's generally benign and safe. However, it is very likely that this patient is symptomatic, hence they have a loop recorder. So this patient may require therapy in the form of a pacemaker to alleviate symptoms. The alternatives would be to treat the atrial fibrillation aggressively, such as with medication or ablation, such that there are no cardioversions because the patient remains in sinus rhythm. This can prevent the need for a pacemaker. In this ECG, the RR interval appears irregular. The QRS is narrow and it is under 3 squares. And the axis is normal, with 1 being positive, AVF being positive. The difficulty here is finding your P waves. And as we have mentioned before, it is a good idea to find 2 clear P waves and then work backwards and forwards to identify the other P waves. So here we have the rhythm strip enlarged. If we identify, there's the PR interval that's normal on that beat. However, the PR interval on the next beat has extended, and continuing that pattern, the PR interval continues to extend. Later in that cycle, it's difficult to make out where the P wave is. And that's where, if you mark out your P waves, you should be able to identify where they're hidden within the T waves. It then becomes clear that there is a P wave in that last T wave that doesn't produce a QRS. The following P wave does produce a QRS. This is therefore a Wenckebach cycle. This is second degree heart block in a Wenckebach cycle. That is low grade AV nodal block and is likely to be benign, particularly in a younger person. And can be stimulated again by drugs or vagal problems. This is unlikely to require treatment. This ECG tells a story as such, and there are several diagnoses to be made. Again, this refers back to the first tutorial, where we spoke about the fact that the conducting system is usually supplied by the right coronary artery, and therefore an inferior STEMI heart block or bradyarrhythmia should always be looked for. and you should try and determine whether there is AV nodal trouble or ischemia or sinus node trouble. So let's look at the ECG again. There we are. So hopefully you can identify there's ST elevation inferiorly. And again, if you mark out two P waves clearly, it should help you make your diagnosis. Often when I present this ECG, it's presented as 2-to-1 heart block. But if we look more closely, we can see all of the P waves there that I've marked with grey arrows. And then the red arrows show the embedded P waves that are hidden within the T waves and the QRSs. It then becomes obvious that the pattern is complete heart block. So this is inferior STEMI with complete heart block. In these cases, there is a good chance that the AV node will recover, particularly if the patient undergoes PCI to reopen the right coronary artery. If the patient has a reasonable blood pressure and is hemodynamically stable, this is usually managed conservatively. If the heart block does not resolve, and it can take up to 2 weeks, then a pacemaker may be required. Here is another example of ST elevation inferiorly. If we look at the beginning of the tracing, the PR interval is normal and the QRS is narrow. Again, marking out the atrial rate, we can see what the PP interval is. And then going forward, we can see that there is a P wave that should be there that is not there. And again, we go forward, no P wave, no P wave, no P wave. Therefore, there is evidence here of sinus node disease in the context of an inferior STEMI, i.e. the blood supply to the sinus nodes has been affected. But there is no evidence of AV nodal disease because the PR interval is normal and the QRS has remained narrow. This is therefore benign and is very likely to recover with conservative management and doesn't need any immediate treatment. Again, hopefully with PCI, that is placing a stent within the right coronary artery and restoring flow to the sinus node, this will recover quickly. There we show the normal PR interval. So the answer is there, sinus node and generally benign. Here we have an example from a 24-hour monitor. It appears that there is a P wave embedded in the T wave of the first QRS and that there is no QRS following this. So this sometimes is reported as 2-to-1 block. However, when we look at the atrial rate and go backwards and forwards, what you can hopefully appreciate is that there is a regular atrial rhythm, but when you go backwards, that P wave has come early and it has a slightly different morphology. This is therefore premature atrial ectopic beat. And because it's come early, the AV node has not yet recovered. So it's physiologically blocked within the AV node. So this is not 2-to-1 block. This is an atrial ectopic that hasn't conducted, and that's physiological and requires no treatment. I just wanted to highlight a few 24-hour monitors, as we often see these in cardiology, and particularly when there are comments about pauses in the rhythm that may require treatment. An example of this one shows AF throughout the recording, and the rate looks quite reasonable, but there's a comment that there is almost a 3-second pause at 4:50 in the morning. When we look at this a bit more closely, we can see that AF is there throughout the recording and the 3-second pause. There we go, the long description, but the bit I've mentioned is the bit to concentrate on. This shows us the heart rate throughout the day. So hopefully you can see that at night the heart rate drops, but throughout the day it goes up and down, showing good chronotropic response. There it is a bit bigger, so you can see overnight the heart rate is slower. And here is the pause, and we zoom in a bit there. And that is 3-second pause occurring at 10 to 5 in the morning. If you remember from the report, there were no symptoms recorded. Therefore, this was an asymptomatic pause occurring at night when there are heavy vagal influences. In this example, it is very unlikely that this will require treatment, as the patient is asymptomatic from this and has good chronotropic response. The key for this, however, is the patient has atrial fibrillation. And as hopefully you're aware, that gives you a 5 times greater risk of stroke, and therefore they need to be assessed for whether they require anticoagulation. Here we have the 22-year-old male with dizzy spells, and hopefully you can read that in the comment, there are periods of dropped P waves overnight. The patient has also had dizzy spells, but the patient has recorded no symptoms during wearing this monitor, has a normal ECG and a normal physical exam. And here is the example. If we look, it's at 5:30 in the morning, and hopefully you can appreciate that there is a P wave without a following QRS. But when we go backwards and when we go forwards, we can see that the PR interval prior to that drop P wave increases, showing a Wenckebach phenomena. A Wenckebach phenomena at night is a normal finding, particularly in a 22-year-old, and is almost always vaguely stimulated. This would require no treatment, particularly as there is no correlation between the symptoms. This is a 76-year-old female with dizzy spells with no evidence of structural heart disease. And here, hopefully you can see that there are P waves that are not conducted. Now, the pause is over 3 seconds, but the essential feature is that there are 3 P waves with only 1 QRS. This cannot be a Wenckebach phenomena. This must be second degree heart block, which means that when we go back to our tutorial, second degree heart block that is not Wenckebach, i.e. 2-to-1 or 3-to-1 block, is high-grade AV nodal disease. This patient has had dizzy spells and has evidence of high AV nodal disease. This patient will require consideration of pacemaker. This is an 84-year-old, short of breath, with a normal echo. What I wanted to demonstrate here on the 24-hour monitor is the patient does have pauses and has nocturnal bradycardia, but there's no symptom correlation. And there is a little bit of diurnal variation. And what we mean by that is at night, the heart rate is slow and it does increase during the day. Therefore, no therapy is required. So the take-home messages here are the same as our bradycardia tutorial. It was more difficult here because there were examples of atrial fibrillation, so you have no clear P wave to use. But just always remember that with atrial fibrillation, the ventricular rate should be irregular. And if it's not, then the atrium is dissociated electrically from the ventricle. It was also clear in some of the questions that you need to find 2 clear P waves and work backwards and forwards to find them all. And that can be very useful for determining whether something is complete heart block or maybe a Wenckebach. Once you've done that, determine what degree of block it is and then decide whether it's dangerous or not to decide whether treatment is required. Hope this has been useful. Thank you.